I finished my series on God-empowered evangelism, but I'm going to linger a little longer. I haven't lingered for a long time. I was known as a lingerer in college. Most likely to linger was in my, you know, the yearbook. So I'm going to go back to my roots. And so and next week, too, for Palm Sunday, we're going to talk about how that ties into evangelism. And then I'm going to talk about this for another week, I believe, after that. And then I'm going to start a series on hearing God, on how God speaks, how God moves, and what God does in the world, with us and for us. But today, I want to talk about revivals. My title is just, What About Revivals? We don't maybe talk about revivals a lot, but of course it ties into this whole idea of men and women coming to faith in Jesus Christ. Look at the Acts, and think about the Acts chapter 2 event we call Pentecost. It was on the day of Pentecost. But for us now as Christians, Pentecost is the first great revival. A revival, true revivals, are times when masses of people are stirred to faith or deeper commitment because of a powerful move of the Holy Spirit. One more time. True revivals are times when the masses of people are stirred to faith or deeper commitment because of a powerful move of the Holy Spirit. That's Pentecost, isn't it? 3,000 are added. 3,000. That's why we wanted to get to 3,000 for the, the fundraiser patio sale to kind of commemorate my sermon and tie it in, kind of connect it. So at Pentecost, 3,000 came. And when revivals happen, the Spirit of God seems to be more active, and so active that many more people come to faith and in an easier fashion than normal. And there's been revivals through the centuries. And usually they come when the church becomes dry and dead and intellectualized instead of, now we need the intellectual side. We need to understand the faith, but that's not the faith. It is a heart faith. And so Pentecost was the first one. We get a preacher who preaches and the Spirit of God falls and convicts people of their sin and they're crying out, what shall we do after they've been cut to the heart? That's the conviction of sin that comes. So Pentecost was our first revival in the New Testament time. If you look at the text of Joshua, he kind of preached a revival as well, and that's in the Old Testament. I'm not going to touch on that. I'm going to talk about some of the revivals that have happened. Now, after Luther lived, he died, in the century afterwards, religion in Lutheranism became very, very cold, hard, intellectualized, no personal faith, very few people excited about Christ, serving God in particular ways because of their commitment to him. It just became religion. I mean, by this is temptation always. This is always a temptation. The church keeps falling into it, treating it as a religion and not as a presentation of a personality who we know as Jesus Christ. So, after they call that the Orthodox period of time, in about the 1600s, the Orthodoxy in Lutheran history. And what happened was it was a reaction. Head and heart will always react with each other because faith is head and heart. It's both. But sometimes we go extreme on one side and then the other. But it hopefully continues to come and find a middle ground. And so the Pietistic revival was created. Well, God created it. Called some people together. And in Germany and in Norway and Scandinavia, in the late 1700s, around 1800, it was in Germany that God called people like guys named Arndt, Spener, Frankie, in Germany. And these had special anointings. And they began to preach, not just the theology, but they started preaching personal faith in Jesus Christ, personal conviction of sin. And they began to talk about fruit. I mean, if you're in the kingdom, if Christ is in you, you will bear fruit. You'll make a difference in the world. And so the Pietists were named, it is a derogatory term from people who used it. And many times they preached revival, and they preached repentance and belief in Jesus Christ. And what happened was many churches shut their doors to these preachers because they were, well, competing, I suppose, but they also had this formalized religion that if you're baptized and you know the doctrine and you do the rituals, that you're in the kingdom. And the Pietists said, no, it's got to be heart. It has to be the presence of the Holy Spirit in a person's heart. In Scandinavia, around 1800s, Hans Hauge, H-A-U-G-E, Hans Hauge, was called by God, and he became a preacher. And we saw revival. And when you see revival, there's true conviction of sin. There's repentance after the word of God is preached. And it seems like it's easier than normal for people to come to faith because the Spirit of God is stirring. And this happened with these guys, both in Germany and Scandinavia. They began to send out missionaries because people got excited about Jesus Christ. They came to a conviction of sin and belief in Jesus, and they began to send out missionaries all over. And Lutherans are one of the first in that area. In Scandinavia, Hauge, if you were a Haugean, you were one who believed in personal faith, believed the Bible is true, believed that we need to show our life through acts of service to others. My grandmother, I just found out recently, my grandmother was influenced by Hauge. Grandpa didn't go to church much. I'm not sure what he believed. But Grandma Selma, she was a Haugean. She was a pietist. She had personal devotions. She believed in a relationship with Jesus Christ, not just knowing about Jesus Christ. Well, in this country, you've heard about the First Great Awakening. That's when the Vikings lost their first Super Bowl. And then there's the second and third and fourth awakening as well. The First Great Awakening in the United States, you may have heard of this, you may not have heard about this, but the First Great Awakening happened from 1720 to about 1740. And it wasn't just in North America, it was also in Europe and England. And some of the key figureheads of this is George Wycliffe, who is from England, and the Wesley brothers. Remember Charles, who wrote all the hymns, and John Wesley. These were the key preachers. Wesley, what did he went on horseback for, was it 200,000 miles, Fred? 200,000? Something like that. 200,000 miles. And he preached. And when he preached, something happened. He was converted by a group of Christians who believed in personal faith in Jesus, that God can make a difference in your life, that it should make, you should be able to see Christ in your life and know Christ personally. That First Great Awakening, the Wesleys, John Wesley and Charles and George Whitfield, came back and forth between Europe, mainly England or Great Britain, and the United States. And there was revival. In this country, they began to have tent revivals or outdoor revivals, which was fairly new. And they began to preach. Part of why they did this was the church, most churches rejected them. Because at this point, again, churches were formalized and intellectualized and got away from personal faith. And so this is always a reaction to that head faith becoming too important, too strong. So the First Great Awakening brought an evangelical message to this country. And wherever George preached in Wesley's, there was conversions. There were conversions on a mass scale. And they met outdoors many times because the churches in local areas wouldn't allow them to. Ben Franklin was not a Christian, but he believed in God. But he had a building that constructed so that these guys, Whitfield mostly, could come and preach. Because the churches said, no, we don't want these preachers in our church. Because they preach personal faith, and they preach things, something different than what we're all about. Second Great Awakening was about 1795 to 1835. Finney was the key leader. Again, Methodist camp meetings popped up. Baptists grew in numbers. Methodists grew in numbers. And the Second Great Awakening again brought this personal faith, but also the power of the Holy Spirit. When revival happens, a lot of times there's outbreaks. It was either speaking in tongues or prophetic utterances, healings, miracles, things like that happened, and they did happen at these awakenings. Now, back in Great Britain, the Welsh revival, Wales is a part of Great Britain, the Welsh revival started in 1904 by Evan Robbins, a very humble guy. And what happened was all of a sudden there was a breakout of revival and people were coming to faith just by the hundreds and by the thousands. And wherever they went, these preachers went, they had meetings multiple days. Churches got together and members for days and days and days. New converts were brought into the church by the thousands. This revival became so powerful that bars emptied out and lost business, and some closed down. Domestic violence deteriorated and almost went away. It is one of the most incredible revivals in the history of the church. But again, the Word of God precedes it. The Word of God is preached, but then all of a sudden people come to faith easier. It's just easier. I don't understand it. But the Spirit's more active and powerful, and we see thousands come to faith. And the Welsh revival just changed that society for decades. Changed it for decades. Let's jump to about 1900, early 20th century, so right around in 1900, just shortly after the new year, the new millennium, or the new century, there was a breakout of revival in Azusa Street in Los Angeles, right around 1900. A breakout. There was a poor church in Los Angeles, a poor church, but they preached on personal faith, and they preached on the power of God and so forth, and the revival fell. The Holy Spirit fell on this group, and they began to meet every single night, and they witnessed miracles, healings, prophetic utterances, and people came alive. And what happened is people from all over L.A. started coming to this poor church. They had a poor preacher, too, but that it doesn't mean what you think it means. And no, in this case, there was one preacher named Seymour, and he was anointed by God. Anointed by God, and they preached a message, and people came from all over Los Angeles and the whole area, people who were from all different churches, denominations, cultural bents, but also financial differences. I mean, this is a poor church, and you had some rich folks coming in there. Everybody started coming in from different areas of life. And this finally, people from all over the country started coming. Then people from all over the world started coming, night after night, having these revivals where God was so central and the Holy Spirit was so present. And this really changed. This was the start of Pentecostalism. The Assemblies of God Church came out of this, because they believed in the power of God and miracles, answered prayer, things like that. And also Pentecostalism started here. All the Pentecostal churches, if you have a church that says Pentecostal on it, it's probably one that started from, has roots in this time frame. And it was an incredible revival. And it brought new life, it breathed new life into a church that was going dry again. Now, in the 1950s and late 50s and 60s and early 70s was called the Charismatic Renewal. Anybody affected by the Charismatic Renewal? I was. Yep, a number of you here. It changed my life because it brought a real God after I was doing religion for a while. I was just a teenager. But the Charismatic Renewal, again, all throughout the country, people were coming to a deeper sense of God, a deeper love for God. Worship began to open up into new ways, and people feeling that they were encountering God in worship. Gifts of the Spirit and so forth. This happened not that long ago, by the way. My whole family, that's where we were converted, through this revival and renewal. It's called the Charismatic Renewal. A lot of pastors in our denomination were brought into a deeper faith or a personal faith or a power in ministry because of this movement. And Billy Graham, for instance, it's too present, but when Billy was in his prime, he would have meetings, and as you know, tens of thousands would come. And he was anointed. Anointed is what Pentecostals use a lot. It's anointed is when the Holy Spirit's really on somebody. And when they speak, the results are much more than would happen just with an individual. Now, some characteristics of a genuine revival. Emphasis on personal relationship with Jesus. Big emphasis on it's not by your baptism as an adult, it's through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. Emphasis on a relationship with a person, with prayer and worship being central, and scripture being central. Two, true repentance. Remember Pentecost? They began to repent. Thousands began to repent of their sins. What shall we do? Repent and believe. True repentance follows revivals, wherever it goes. It's true repentance. People repenting of their sins, seeing their sins more clearly, coming to faith in the gracious God in Christ. Miracles and healings. When we were growing up, when I was growing up at age 13, my brothers and sisters older than me, we saw angels, miracles happen, answered prayer, healings. God was moving so commonly and so often. It changed us. We were all changed by this. We became familiar with the God who's there, who's real, who's powerful. We have to fight that, and that's what this is. Revivalism helps to bring a church back from dry formalism, where it's doctrine-based only. We want doctrine-based, but that's not the faith. That protects the faith. The faith is knowing and living with the person Jesus Christ. There's no amen. I just wanted to try that. My Baptist friends get that all the time. That felt good. increase in prayer. In fact, a lot of times there's prayer foundations to revivals, meaning there's people that have been called to pray for a certain nation or a certain area, and they pray for years, if not decades at times. So a lot of times revivals come after appeals by God's people to bring a revival. Fresh love for worship. I remember when I was converted, the Holy Spirit fell on me, and I just began to worship God. Worship, all of a sudden, I got it, and I wanted to worship him. In fact, the most enjoyable thing in all the world for me is worship because of that experience. I just want to worship God. I worship God all day. You can't help it, can you? You just can't. Thirst for Scripture. As a 13-year-old, I began to read the Bible all the time. All the time. I had a thirst for Scripture. A lot of times, revivals at certain times really changes that. People begin to love the Scriptures more, read the Scriptures more, listen to the Scriptures, obey the Scriptures more. But Scripture becomes very central, and people have a thirst for it. A thirst for it. Also, opposition from religious leaders. Almost every revival we talked about today, almost every revival, there was opposition from religious institutions. It's kind of strange. That's why there's so much outdoor preaching. And it really worked well because sometimes there weren't churches big enough to hold these revivals. But opposition. And we really got to look at this. And I think what's happening is this tendency for us to formalize religion. It happens naturally over time. We don't do it on purpose. But a live faith through generations begins to maybe die and becomes less personal. And it becomes more of a duty or impersonal or doctrinal or whatever. Then finally, interdenominational. Not finally in my sermon. I mean, I still got a half an hour to go. I mean, finally on this list, okay? I got more lists here. My wife made sure I picked as I left home today. She is my finder. I'm a loser. She's a finder. Interdenominationalism. Back when I was 13, my brothers and sisters were all converted, also received just the power of the Holy Spirit. And during that time, we began to, all over the country, small groups would start. We started in homes from people from different denominations. I used to go as a teenager to a Catholic church where they were all affected by this revival, and nuns and priests were raising their hands, worshiping God, believing and praying for miracles and healings. It was Catholics and Lutherans, all kinds of Protestants mixing with each other. You'll see a unity that comes out of this. Dave Drum has set a nice road here for us. We believe that when churches get together more and unite, that there's a greater chance that God is going to honor that and say, okay, you guys are united, I'm going to work with you. But that's a beautiful thing, isn't it? And back then, we didn't see people as Presbyterians or Catholics, you know, or anything like that. We just saw them as believers who were excited about Jesus Christ. Why am I talking about revivals? Well, first of all, it's nice to know the history of revivals. But also in this, one takeaway is we got to watch ourselves from moving into formalism, into just rote and basic stuff that is just churned in our minds but not in our heart. We got to watch out for that because it's going to happen as individuals too. You may need a revival, just a personal revival, because you kind of lost something. You know, that happens with us. I got so excited about Jesus Christ. I loved him more than anything. I read the scriptures, prayed, whatever, but then you go through a period where that changes. You get busy. Hard times come, and you kind of move out of that. And so you may need a personal revival today, a new relationship with Jesus Christ with renewed power. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. We read in Scripture as the disciples were preparing for Pentecost. But also, we need to pray for revival. Let's pray for revival and start praying for revival for this church, this congregation, and then this city and this country. You know in this country, you know that there's some problems. And we need to pray for moral revival and spiritual revival. We need to pray for that. We need to start begging God, bring revival. Because I saw what happened when I was young. People came to Christ, kids our own age, they're just coming to Christ. You just said a few words and bam, they're Christian. During revivals, evangelism is simple, and people are open. It's a strange thing. It's a strange thing. But let's pray for revival here in this church. Let's start here. Let's go to Tucson, and let's go to the whole country, because we need Christ. We need deeper power and direction of the Holy Spirit. We need people who are excited about Jesus Christ. That's why we have Alpha. That's why we have John 17, is that they help stimulate personal revival, of course, and renewal. But we need to pray for revival of this church, town, and country, so that the work of God in these churches, in our church as well, will become more powerful and see greater fruit. I want to pray right now for all of that to happen. Heavenly Father, we pray right now for revival. Lord Jesus, we have a country that needs to be revived. We need renewal. We need Jesus. We need excitement about our life with you. I pray for just a revival among us now. And we pray, God, also that you revive, bring people to lead revival, bring pastors, evangelists, and so forth to have a part in all this. But we pray that in this town of Tucson as well, that we would see men and women coming to faith in Christ on a much accelerated basis. We are praying for revival so that your children, Father, can receive more power in their ministry and work. We pray for revival, Lord Jesus, so that Jesus' name can be lifted up and received by many who don't yet know him. So we pray for revival in this country, again, moral and spiritual, so that you might be honored, so that men and women by the thousands and tens of thousands would come to know you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.